said by your shoulders. When they looked at him, they said this strangely human face, this odd face. They expected to see a huge spatula nose and heavy.
Please support this channel by subscribing and leaving comments.
He's learned over the last 30, 40 years, also what his nonprofit research group, which is funded from back east from a nonprofit group, to discuss why he's interested and why he's attempting to define more of the characteristics of this mythological, hopefully classified being. So, Mr. Byrne? Well, by the way, my name's Rick Weidel. I'm just a fellow with Patterson where I live.
Mystery, as we all know, intriguing mystery, exciting mystery, and it's one that attracts the attention of lots of people. I think there's maybe three or four people on the other four rooms, and it's great. I'll tell you what we're doing with the project. I'll tell you what I know about Bigfoot history after all these years, and just discuss it generally, and then we can have a little question about it if you wish. The project is designed with something which is rather far-fetched. Yeah. The project is designed to try and find one of these creatures and attempt to communicate, see if we can make contact and attempt to communicate. We have no aims towards capturing one, no aims towards shooting one. If you're shooting one, would be wrong, and just the proof that they're there. And this is what we're trying to do. We have a staff of four. We're based in Parkdale, Oregon, and we have not only very, very good equipment, but we also have access through funding to probably the best equipment that's available anywhere in the world at this time, including, for instance, Byrne, FLIR, which is forward looking infrared. There's a company in Hillsborough called Hillsborough Helicopter, and they have one of these units. And this is a unit which can read heat emanations. It's used from an aircraft. It's a marvelous piece of equipment. It's very high technology. It's also very expensive. It's about $1,000 a day for rental. We would use that to search on the basis of a find. It's not something that you just rent and fly up and down the mountains. First of all, you have to find something very difficult, all the fresh evidence, and then we would use that. We see the Bigfoot, and I see it not as an expert. I see it as a student of Bigfoot law. I see it as being a primate of some kind, possibly a hominid form. We're not sure of that, of course. It's bipedal in its gait, it walks upright, the only thing that walks upright in the world, apart from us. It's apart from the Bigfoot, it's of course us, the only creatures that walk on 2 feet in the world. But as Sandy pointed out, the other day, ostriches and boobies. Our research suggests that things are about 6 feet in height, not much bigger than that, heavily built, totally air covered, with the base bare of their arms and hands, the soles and feet, tremendously heavy shoulders, massive chest, big arms, but arms that are not of abnormal length, like for instance the arms of chimpanzees and gorillas, which hang below the waistline. The arms of these things apparently are very much like human arms. Five fingers on hands, five toes, and as has been pointed out to us by people say they've seen one of these things, a strangely human face. And we had this told to us again and again by people who've been up fairly close within 30 or 40 feet, who've seen one, and it's expected to see something like a girl, expected to see a baby. And of course, in these encounters where people have actually seen one, there's always shock, there's always surprise. And I'll give you an example. One of our best sightings from last year was a couple who saw one. They told us up here in Mount St. Evans. Sorry, Mount Evans. It was evening time, it was about 6:30. And it was just getting dusk. And this man and his wife and two little children were driving in the pickup. He just turned on his headlights, came around the corner, and one of these things stepped off the road on the right-hand side. Looked at him and crossed the road in front of him. The man was absolutely intrigued with what he saw, and he put his foot on the brake. His wife leaned across, knocked both doors, and shouted at him, "Drive, drive." She didn't want him to stop. He continued on, he saw it in the mirror, and then it was out of his sight. What was very interesting about that particular sighting was that where the thing came off the road, there was a Forest Service sign, and both of the adults told me, we were able to question them separately, but the head of the thing was about 5 inches below the top of the sign. So we went back to the area and we found the sign and we measured it. The top of the sign was six inches from the ground, indicating that the head of this thing, the top of his head, was about 6 feet from the ground. They said what they told us, what a lot of people told us, they said it appeared to have no neck. In other words, a very, very thick, short neck. Obviously it has a neck. But they said it had no neck. Its head was set by the shoulders. And then it looked at they said this strangely human face, this hard face. They expected to see a huge spatula nose and heavy brows, but the face to them looked human. And we had the opportunity of questioning them separately, which is very good for questioning people, both of whom had seen the same thing. And we were convinced this was a very credible report. It was also a rare report. In 1993, we had five reports like this, five sightings. You see a lot of stuff in newspapers and magazines, perhaps maybe take hundreds of sightings. But maybe we don't know about it. In 93, which is basically the first year of our project, we had these five sightings, and that's all. If anybody has questions, please, I'll be staying here.
If they're 6 foot, about 6 feet tall, what accounts for reports of having a very long stride and covering great distances when they stride?
Well, the stride is not abnormal. The height of 6 feet, I suggest, is an average height. There are some that would be bigger than that. I'm 6 feet tall, I'm 33 in stride. These things have a 40, perhaps a 45 in stride. That is the stride I might make. If I was stepping out of perhaps you would like it. It is a long stride. It's a different creature, it's not a human. So it would have a different stride than us. And 48 to 45 inches is not abnormal.
Peter, would you consider, I'm guessing or I've been referred to orangutans, but in the makeup of the population, that there are females out there, the males? Because you're not needing to have more males, if males might make a circuit. Is that true in large population?
I don't question if that makes males happy.
Well, there is apparently a real sexual dimorphism in the sizes of these things, male and female, so maybe there are more females out there who can be smaller.
We don't know the answer to that. I have to say, at the very beginning here, all the knowledge that we have, with basically almost no exception, speculating that things are climbing, speculating that they do this, they do that, speculating that they're omnivorous. People ask me how many of you think there are. I have absolutely no idea. It could be 10, it could be 1,000. The Pacific Northwest can certainly hide 1,000 of these things. One of the examples I give to people who are skeptical is that there are 73 aircraft lost in the mountains here, all California to Alaska since World War II. There's a 73 aircraft that are down on the ground, which are knocking down. One of them has two sensors on board. It was a charter jet, the signal was in distress, and it went down. And one of the sensors was sent to Hale Box, Washington, D.C., I forget the name of the other. The families are still looking at that aircraft. An aircraft is a massive metal, smashed into the side of the mountain or into the trees, and it's there. It's not moving, it's not trying to get away, it's not trying to hide. And when an aircraft goes down, it's an enormous search. Hundreds of people, perhaps even thousands involved. In this case, we have 73 of those aircraft which we can't find. I guess it's a good example. Perhaps of the formidable nature of the terrain of the Pacific Northwest in which these things live.
Do you think they migrate?
Oh, you're talking. That's a question that's very, very puzzling. Because we find footprints in the summertime. I found five sets of footprints in 30 years. And sometimes, very rarely, footprints are found in the winter. But more footprints should be found in the winter, because anyone can see a footprint. A mouse can make footprints in snow. Anyone can find footprints in snow. Anyone who's on an outline can see footprints in snow. And there are footprints all the time, very, very few. So do they hide any? I don't know. I have no idea.
Trying to get fellow culture in.
My name is Trying to make
true hibernation.
A true hibernation is something that means the creature, perhaps like the ground squirrel, goes into a home of a cocoon and stays in that state for maybe 5 or 6 months, right through the freezing time. So do they hibernate? Sorry, I don't know. I didn't know. Yes.
In terms of food, a creature of size definitely require a lot of nourishment. What would you speculate with this?
I would think it would be omnivorous, and if there are, there's tons of food out there. In some areas, the city northwest, there's more than 100 edible plants per square mile. I think a good example of a creature which can survive, which is an omnivorous creature, is the bear. Bears eat everything. You find out bark of trees, mulberry roots, sedges. They'll graze on grass like a cow if they're hungry, and the bears survive. The black bear is not hungry. That's why I think they may lie out for short periods. So it's out there in the winter. deer around there, they don't hide like the elk. These animals are plenty of food. The four basic requirements of all creatures are food, water, color, and space. And out there in the mountains of the city more or less, we have food, we have water, and tons of cover, hundreds of miles of forest, and lots of space. Yes, ma'am.
You were associated with Jerry Crew in Northern California at one time. So, the sort of trap. I understand that you were in the field and then what did you find?
In Northern California, one of the first people we met, I think it was in January 1960, was a man called Jerry Crew. And we took him into the group and employed him for a year, in his death group. And he was quite a good woodsman. And he's one of the people who found the first tracks in an area called Blood Creek in 1959. This is all documented. And we did a few field trips together. We did a lot more field trips in those days than we do nowadays, because we find that basically field trips, which means going up to footprints or looking for a site on Lund, they're just too time consuming and you just don't produce them. However, one time I was out with Jerry Crew and did find something which was very interesting. We walked out these creeks, and something we did in those days, we'd pick a long creek, 25 or 30 miles long, we'd drive up to the head of it, and then we'd walk all the way down to the side, looking for footprints and mud and sand, and hoping to see something.
If you're enjoying all this rare and unique content, please show your support by subscribing and leaving comments.